I have duty to introduce Professor Michael Spira. Michael Spira, of course, is known to high energy physics community for a very, very long time. And because most of you are young, I would take this opportunity to introduce him to all of you. Michael actually started about 30 years back, you know, his work on doing radiative corrections in perturbative QCD. When the rest of the world was doing tree-level computations in QCD, and as a young graduate, he started with one-loop corrections with masses for the production of Higgs at hadron colliders. That was, I would say, is one of the toughest computations. Even today, actually, I would say, you know, for young graduate students to really do it by hand, starting, you know, writing down all the Feynman diagrams, doing all the integrations right, and then getting the cross-sections right, it's not an easy task. And as a young graduate, he did it. And it is one of the landmark calculations even today, actually. It's got more than 1,000 citations, which is not actually easy, okay, in phenomenology, I would say. Okay, and he is achiever of such a fantastic calculation as a graduate student and an inspiring person. And after that, actually went on to do many such calculations, not only in perturbative QCD, also in physics beyond standard model. And many of them are landmark computations, actually. And I'm really, you know, grateful to him that he agreed. And we are going to have a wonderful set of lectures by him. I heard from him yesterday, you know, his plan. And in fact, I like the way he's going to plan his talks. And I want you to enjoy his talks. And about these colors, I think, you know, people would ask less number of questions will be asked to go out first, actually. So compete with the rest of the, you know, fellow Mets. The most number of questions, you know, means that you are not one of those first 10, actually. Okay? So please ask a lot of questions because it's school and you should be bugged as much as possible, actually. I hope you don't mind. Okay, so let me welcome. Maybe I'll also tell his profile, actually, after his, you know, I've only said about graduate time, actually, after his PhD in Aachen, he moved to Hamburg University, DESI, and then CERN as a fellow, and then went back to Hamburg, and for the last 20 years, he's in PSI, Willingen. So,
thank you very much for this nice introduction. At first, I would say that I'm stuttering, therefore, it might be that from time to time, I have some problems to speak, but I'm asking for your patience because I will definitely go on. Okay, the basic purpose of my lecture is to give a basic introduction into perturbative QCD. I am belonging to a certain kind of school who is teaching QCD in a more intuitive way, which means my main emphasis will be on the intuitive pictures behind, because I need this for my personal understanding of what I'm doing in detail. So this means everything which is awful in the theoretical calculations is then just a required deed that you have to do to reach the results that you would like to reach. Therefore, in the first part of my lecture, I will give a basic introduction into the basics of QCD, and I hope that I will be able to finish this today, so that tomorrow I can start to introduce in principle the historical content, how we came to the notion that there is a perturbative part of QCD, what is perturbative, that we have to introduce parton density functions which are in principle non-perturbative, but they are factorizing from the perturbative part, and these objects are universal so that you can perform a global fit to determine them. So this goes back to the nuclear structure functions where the partons have been discovered in 1968. Then I will move over to E plus and minus, in principle to hadrons. This is in principle one of the tests of QCD, precision tests of QCD. Discuss the Dreyan process. This is the third process where you can really perform a precision test in some basic process. Then I will discuss in principle jets in E plus and minus and hadron scattering. And I will also discuss QCD tests in heavy quarkonium decays, because a lot of people don't talk about J-Psi and Upsilon decays, because also there you can perform jet studies and test also the color charges of the gluons. And if time permits, at the end, I was asked also to add some part of the lecture on effective field theory. So I will summarize the basic ingredients of the old theory of weak interactions called Fermi theory, which only has been completed 2012 with the discovery of the Higgs boson. Quite recently, I've seen a movie about Marie Curie because they were announcing that radioactive decay can only be understood once you're combining the relativistic approach and quantum mechanics. And I told my wife that this has been completed in 2012, and this was really a long way to go. Then I will discuss QCD in the presence of a heavy top quark, how you're decoupling a top quark, what the top quark really means in the limit of heavy cases, also for the Higgs coupling to the gluons, and the Higgs coupling to the gluons is a crucial coupling for the LSC. This is, of course, mediating the dominant Higgs production mode where the Higgs pair has been discovered. And then finally, I will add some comments about what we are calling SMEFT, or Standard Model Effective Field Theory. Literature, I think you have the list. The books which are coming closest to my way of the lecture is the very first by Muta, the second by Ellis, Stirling, and Weber. And for example, my probabilistic approach to the derivation of the Altarelli-Breezy equations can also be found in the textbook by Chris Quick. But all the other books are, of course, standard textbooks where you can learn QCD stuff from. Introduction of color. So it means I'm first introducing what we are talking about in this school. The historical definition of strong interactions, of course, was meant to describe the binding force of nucleus inside the nucleus. So really the binding force inside the nucleus of an atom. And in addition, also the force in nuclear-nuclear scattering, because at that time it was not so clear how these two different forces are in principle combined. Then in 1964 was a very special year, Gell-Mann introduced his quark picture. CP breaking in the KK bar system has been discovered. Color has been introduced in this year. And the Higgs has been introduced in this year. So 1964 was a very special year, also for myself, because this is the year that I'm born. And the quark picture immediately posed a huge problem, because you were impossible collecting all the bound states of the quarks into multiplets of hadrons. And there was one particular hadron called the delta plus plus, which is a spin 3/2 baryon. The favor decomposition was due to three identical up quarks with spin up in order to combine to the total spin 3/2. And this is a completely symmetric wave function. However, since this is a fermion, the wave function should better be anti-symmetric due to Fermi statistics. So this was an open problem, how to make this wave function anti-symmetric if you're really relying on the quark picture. One option would be to assume that the ground state is not an S wave, but you are introducing an angular momentum equal to one, so that the ground state is a P wave. Then, of course, the Lorentz part of the wave function becomes anti-symmetric. But this is in contradiction to the naive and also the experimental experience, because P wave bound states are normally unstable bound states. So this option has been given up. And in addition, in order to save the quark picture, there was a strong argument at that time, because you could predict the magnetic moments of the nucleons quite easily by working out all the Clebsch-Gortons by binding in principle the fundamental magnetic moments of the constituent quarks. And then you are in principle writing down the proton wave function and work out all the Clebsch-Gortons. And then the basic prediction was that the ratio between the magnetic moment of the proton and the neutron is exactly -3/2 plus some corrections, because this is of course a quite rough estimate. And the experimental measurement was very close to this prediction, and this was handled as a strong argument in favor of the quark picture. So the only solution that you had at that time was to add another quantum number, which leads, if possible, to some asymmetric wave function. And this means that quarks have to carry a three-valued differentiator, so that a symmetric quark model was impossible. But in principle, the corresponding piece of the wave function connected to this additional quantum number was then anti-symmetric. So this was the first time that the hypothesis of color was introduced in 1964 by Greenberg. Next to flavor charges, all the quarks carry color charges. Each quark appears in exactly three colors. And for the outside people, they were called red, blue, and green, or 1, 2, 3. But in principle, in our practical application, of course, this is the SU3 symmetry that you're introducing for the color degrees of freedom. And this is an SU3 that was known, of course, from the quark picture, but it's a different SU3. So in principle, the SU3 between up, down, and strange is the SU3 flavor group, which is not exact, it's approximate, and you can also control the violations of the SU3 flavor in terms of all the methods that were known from the 60s and the 70s, but this is an exact symmetry, which means you're introducing color transformations as SU3 rotations. So, in principle, SU3 is a Lie group. So this means any element of this Lie group has an exponential representation in that way that you have some constants alpha k, which can principle change. And then you have the generators in terms of the Gell-Mann, in principle, in terms of the Gell-Mann matrices of SU3. A particular representation of the Gell-Mann matrix is in principle depicted here. The basic structure is very simple because you are embedding all the Pauli matrices in the upper left corner, and then you are continuing with the Pauli matrices also in the other entries, because these are always the first two Pauli matrices, and then the last generator is also diagonal, which means that two of these generators are diagonal, they are commuting, which means that two of these eigenvalues of these generators are in principle commuting, and we are calling this a Lie group of rank 2. This just as a side remark, because this is not important for the content of my lecture. The basic properties is that these generators are Hermitian, because this means that these group elements are all unitary, so they are normalized to 1. If you are in principle multiplying you'd dagger with you. And these generators are traceless, which means that the determinant of any object of this group equal to +1. And this, of course, exclude also faces between in principle that are attributed to all these generators. Then we are normalizing the generators of SU3 as being half of the Gell-Mann matrices. And then you can construct the in principle, the basic Lie algebra that the commutator of two of these generators is a linear combination of all the generators again. This means that the whole algebra is closed and that you're really dealing in terms of a closed group. The structure constants F, A, B, C are totally entosymmetric, which means if two of these indices are equal, then of course these structure constants have to vanish. Then you have a relation for the intercommutator of two of these generators. They are introducing symmetric structure constants D, A, B, C. And the trace is normalized to 1/2 times the Kronecker symbol, which means that the trace of two of these generators, two of these generators, if they are different, is vanishing. And this is only equal to 1/2 if in principle these generators are the same. And these generators, of course, based on this property, are traceless. This just for calculational purposes. Then in 1972, Gell-Mann came up with a stronger statement about color, because he assumed that the SU3 color symmetry is exact, is unbroken. So this means it's completely exact, different from the SU3 flavor, which is not exact. And that all physical, which means free states, observables, and the interactions are SU3 singlets. What does it mean? This is the first statement in 1972 about what we are calling confinement now, that all colored objects are confined in bound states and cannot act as free particles, which is in line with the experimental experience that up to now there's no real evidence for the existence of free quarks. If you're not entering a quark gluon plasma, then inside the plasma, of course, you can find them, but not outside. Then, with this SU3 degree of freedom, you can add an entosymmetric wave function for the color degrees of freedom to make all the baryons entosymmetric. You are multiplying this just with a Levi-Civita tensor in 3 dimensions, normalize this properly, and then you have an entosymmetric color wave function, so that the full wave function of the delta plus plus becomes entosymmetric, and that and also the Fermi statistics are saved. And for the mesons, which are quark anti-quark bound states, you are just introducing a Kronecker system, which means that the colors of the quark and the anti-quark are in principle always compensating each other. You can prove from group theory that these are the only two objects which are really SU3 singlets. This is a simple exercise that can be performed, so that the baryons, which are in principle because this means that all the bound states which are constructed out of these basic ingredients of the color wave functions are in principle color white. For example, the delta plus plus has this wave function where the I, J, and K are now the color degrees of freedom of the quarks, and they are completely anti-symmetrized. And for example, the phi, which is a strange anti-strange bound state of spin equal to one, in principle has a symmetric color factor, but then of course you don't have any other constraint on the wave function in principle that has to make it anti-symmetric because this is a boson. So this is a completely symmetric wave function. Now, what does it mean that also the interactions are SU3 singlets? For example, if you are in principle starting with the electromagnetic interaction, which is just the coupling of the electromagnetic quark current in principle to the photons, then you are summing up all the quark flavors with the corresponding quark charges in this current. And if you're including also the color degree of freedom, then in this expression also the colors of the quarks and anti-quarks are summed up. Which means what you're really introducing as a color object is just this Kronecker symbol, which is an SU3 singlet, which means if you're applying all these SU3 color transformations to this quark, to this quark and interquark triplets, then you can show that this is completely symmetric so that this electromagnetic current is a white object, so that electromagnetic interactions are insensitive to the color degrees of freedom directly, but there are some consequences where the color plays a role for the electromagnetic interactions, because now we have three different types of quarks, one red, one green, one blue. This leads me to the general historical outcome, that, of course, the number of colors can be tested in experiment. And in the, because the basic point is that in the 60s and the early 70s, there were two basic observables where you could in principle count the number of colors. The first observable is the neutral pion decay into a pair of photons. I skip the derivation of this decay width because this decay width, of course, has to be calculated by using dispersion integrals and using the Arta-Belcher-Keefe anomaly, because this was the crucial breakthrough in 1969 to solve the puzzle of the pion decay into two photons. But the outcome of the whole calculation is this simple expression at leading order. The crucial point is that this expression relates the pion to a pair of photons to the pion mass, the pion decay constant, which can be determined from the charged pion decay into leptons. Then the square difference of the principle of the up and the down quark charges, which have to be known beforehand. But of course, from the construction of the quark picture, of course, you knew which electric charges the quarks in principle should carry. And then everything is multiplied by the square of the color number. Which means if you're measuring this decay and use this theoretical prediction, you can extract this factor NC squared and see if this factor NC, if this factor NC is equal to 3 or even more. Without color, you are getting a basic prediction that this decay width is impossible slightly less than 1 electron volt. With color, you are getting some prediction of close to 8 electron volts. Now the experimental measurement of this decay width is also close to 8 electron volts. So this is a confirmation that you need this factor of 9 to reproduce the experimental measurements. Nowadays, of course, all these predictions are more precise because you can use perturbation theory. This is a part of, because this is a part of strong interactions that I will not cover in my lectures. And then, of course, the agreement between the experimental measurement and the theoretical prediction is still fine. So that this is a proof that the number of colors is equal to 3, provided that you are attributing the correct electric charges to the up and the down quark. Some people claim that there's a correlation between the number of colors and also the charges of the up and the down quark, and that in principle this is not a unique proof. But once you are assuming the charges of the up and the down quark to get consistency with the quark picture to predict also the electric charges of all the barons, then of course this is a proof that the number of colors is equal to 3. Then in the early 70s, there was a second observable that could be tested, which is E plus and minus into hadrons. But this requires already some assumptions. The basic assumption is that in the quark parton picture, which I will explain in more detail during the lecture, The production probability of E plus and minus in two hadrons is determined by the one for quark interquark pairs, which means that for the full process of E plus in principle of E plus and minus, mediated by an offshore photon into any hadrons can be distributed in a two-step process. First, you are producing a quark interquark pair, and the quark interquark pair then hadronizes into the hadronic final state. And this is very important because this is first a probabilistic picture that the probability of these quarks and the interquarks to hadronize is equal to one, and that this hadronization is independent of the production process. This is some universality hypothesis. And this is true, at least with hand-waving arguments. If the if the production distance at which the quark-interquark pair is produced is in principle much smaller than the typical hadronization distance. So this means you always need a hierarchy between different scales, different distances, in order to have something that we are calling factorization. And the larger the hierarchy, the better the factorization works, because we also know this from classical classical mechanics, how to describe our solar system, because you can first focus on the system of the sun and the earth, including the moon, of course, up to a certain extent, and then treat all the influence of the other planets as perturbations. This is based on a hierarchy that the dominant interaction, which controls the orbit of the earth, is dictated by the earth-moon system and the sun. And all the other ingredients are perturbations, and this means that you can also use a perturbative expansion. This perturbative expansion is not converging, but is useful. Okay, and this is a limit that will repeat a lot of times during the lecture, because you need such a hierarchy in order to have factorization. So in the high energy case, of course, this factorization should work better. And this is one of the reasons why QCD, perturbative QCD, works at high energies, because this means that you are dealing with quark-interquark pairs in a perturbative sense. This is a very basic picture, which will repeat in many other applications in different ways. Then in this way, you can compute the R ratio, which is the ratio between the total hadronic cross-section divided by the E plus and minus to mu minus cross-section. And this R ratio is sensitive to the number of three colors. Now it's not Nc squared, it's Nc, because all the quarks are produced incoherently, times the sum of the squared charges of all the contributing quarks. Now, this R ratio, of course, depends on the energy scale, because the energy scale tells me which quarks can be kinematically produced. Which means, for energies below 3G, where you are below the charm threshold, you can only produce up, down, and strange. Then the R ratio without this factor of three is simply provided by the sum of the squared charges, and with color, you are getting three times this ratio. Then you can repeat the same thing for energies above 5 GeV, where you have to add the charm, above 5 GeV, that you are far away from the from the range of all the charm resonances. Then you are getting some prediction from the square of the charges of the R ratio, and times 3 for the R ratio with color, and you can also continue with the bottom quark for energies above 10 GeV, and then you get a prediction without color and with color. And this here is not a modern plot, it's a historical plot. This is a plot where this R ratio is simply plotted as a function of the center of mass energy at the E plus and minus collider. The dashed lines are those lines for the R ratio without colors, and the full lines are the predictions including colors. And this is a clear confirmation that you need three colors to describe the E plus and minus annihilation into hadrons. Nowadays, this plot is much more accurate and much more in agreement with perturbative QCD. Of course, you have to add also higher order corrections in order to solve some of these small discrepancies, but this is well understood now. And this means it's that well understood that you can use, for example, the E plus and minus annihilation into hadrons to fit the non-perturbative part of the hadronic contribution to the running of the fine structure constant, or also in principle the hadronic contribution to the anomalous magnetic moment of the electron and the muon. Then, of course, if the SU3 is exact, then quite often, if you are introducing an exact global symmetry, then theorists are always making these symmetries local to have them implemented at a very fundamental level, because there are many theorems which are controlling also the local symmetries. Local ones are always a much stronger statement than the global ones, because local symmetries must never be broken. So it means even the electroweak symmetries, in practical terms, not broken, the Higgs just decouples. It was with the local symmetry from the spectrum of the observables and the interactions. And this is what happens with the Higgs mechanism. So this led to the second color hypothesis, and this was really the final goal, the beginning of real QCD. Color charges are sources of gauge fields, which leads to the introduction of gluons that build up the strong interaction between quarks. And if you're introducing gauge fields, then you're introducing a local symmetry. This idea has first been written down by Nambu in 1966. His model did not work just because he attributed the wrong charge quantum numbers to the quarks, and therefore the predictions impossible out of his approach were failing, so that this work has been forgotten by many other people, because the first real explicit write-down of the QCD Lagrangian was done by Fritsch and Gell-Mann in 72 and independently by a Swiss guy, Lloyd Vira, in 1973, and this was really the basic of QCD, but everything has not been possible without the renormalization proofs by Toft and Feldman. So this was really the major breakthrough in our field, and then suddenly the notion of non-abelian symmetries in principle attracted a lot of attention, and then in the early 70s, as you may know, the major developments have been performed. Also on the experimental side, because the discovery of neutral currents, charm quarks, bottom quarks, everything happened in the 70s. The Lagrangian for such a color triplet contains first, of course, the kinetic term of the quarks. But here you have to replace the partial derivative by the covariant derivative, which means the partial derivative minus the strong coupling constant times the gluon field. And this is meant by the covariant derivative. What this gluon field means, I will come in a second. Then, of course, the quarks have to be independent of the quark charges. Otherwise, you are breaking the SU3 symmetry again. This Lagrangian is invariant with respect to local non-abelian SU3 color transformations, which means that the quarks are transforming in principle by multiplying any arbitrary group element with some constants alpha k, which are now space-time dependent. So this means that building up the derivative also picks out the derivative of these in principle of these coefficients, and then the anti-quarks are in principle transforming with the inverse element of the SU3 group. Then you have to introduce 8 minimally coupled gluon fields. Why 8 fields? Because we have 8 generators in SU3. Gauge bosons are always sitting in the joint representation of any Lie group, which means that the color degrees of freedom in principle of the gluons, the color index, in principle is the same index as the number index of the generator. Which means we have 8 different generators. One of the impossible due to the fact that one of these generators has that all of these generators have to be traceless. We have in total 9 minus 1 generators, so 8 generators. Any SUN group has n squared minus 1 generators. And then you are constructing the gluon fields by multiplying these 8 gluon fields with the corresponding generators, which means that this is a gluon matrix in color space. And this gluon matrix, of course, acts, of course, on the color degrees of freedom of the quarks. Then you can show that the gluon field, then you introduce, in principle, also the transformation of the gluon field as being a rotation plus a shift. This is just the generalization of the gauge transformation of the photon field in the abelian case. In the abelian case, all these S factors are just phases. So this means that the first expression in principle commutes so that you can kill all the phases. So this means for the abelian case, you have the photon field replaced by the photon field minus because this means that in principle this minus in principle the derivative of these constants alpha here. So, because this simply means that in principle this is consistent also with the gauge transformation of the photon field in abelian QED. With this, you can show that the covariant derivative in this way just transforms as a pure rotation. And this is really the central issue here, because there you don't have any additional partial derivative with respect to this space-time-dependent constant alpha k. Then, impossible after this has been done, because this is a more systematic way how to derive that this Lagrangian is completely symmetric, because in this way you in principle, you also recognize why it's so useful to introduce this covariant derivative. Then you can construct the, in principle, the kinetic term of the, in principle of the gluon field by just defining the gluon field in terms of the commutator of these two covariant derivatives. So this means everything that we are introducing in principle in QCD that contains a partial derivative can be re-expressed in terms of the covariant derivative. This simply leads to the fact that this gluon field strength 10 tensor also transforms as a pure rotation in SU3 color space. And then if you work out in principle the corresponding expression of the gluon field, then you find the corresponding term that we know also from QED for the photon. But the main difference is a commutator of the gluon fields, which does not vanish because the generators of SU3 do not commute. In QED, this commutator vanishes. So this means that this is also a generalization from the abelian QED example. Then you can construct the kinetic term of the gluon fields by just taking the trace of the square of this field strength tensor, because in this trace, the effect of the rotation cancels, so that this term is SU3 symmetric. And then you have to normalize this, and if you are in principle using the same decomposition as before for the gluon field, now for the gluon field strength tensor, you can prove that this is the properly normalized 8 kinetic terms of the gluon fields. So this means this is consistent with everything that we know, at least from QED. And this is, of course, manifestly invariant under local SU3 rotations. A side remark, a mass term of that kind is not possible because the gluon field itself has a non-trivial shift, which destroys the symmetry of such a mass term, which leads to the notion that, of course, if you have an exact local symmetry, then the gauge bosons have to be massless. If you want to introduce massive gauge bosons, then you have to do something in addition, and the something in addition is uniquely identified as being a scalar sector, a Higgs sector, which spontaneously breaks the symmetry, and by means that non-trivial ground state is formed in the scalar potential. Okay, then it is very important that even if you don't include quarks in this theory, there's no impossible, because this means that in this so it means even if you don't introduce quarks, then this theory already contains interactions, which means a free non-abelian gauge theory is an interacting theory. There's no, there's no part of the Lagrangian that is free of interactions. So this is also a major difference to QED because the pure kinetic term of the photons does not include interactions, only bilinear terms, which means that this term contains the kinetic part of the gluons, which are defining the in principle, they are defining the gluon propagator in the final end, but due to the commutator inside the gluon field strength tensor, there's also a trilinear coupling proportional to the strong coupling constant, and a quartic gluon coupling proportional to the square of the strong coupling constant. But this means that already the strong coupling constant is in principle uniquely defined in the gauge sector. And this means that we have self-interactions of the gluon fields, that the gluon fields are also color charged in the adjoint representation that you can represent by the color and the anti-color up to a certain extent. But this is a pure group theoretical statement, so that the gluons are also sources of gluons. So this means that gluons can radiate gluons and all these things. Strong coupling is universal, fixed in the gauge sector. And this means that in non-abelian gauge theories, all the gauge quantum numbers are quantized. The electric charge in QED is not quantized. You can rescale all the electric charges of all particles by an arbitrary amount, even rational or irrational, and still the symmetry is preserved. So this means in the standard model context, we don't have any explanation why the electric charge or the hypercharge is quantized. You only have the boundary condition that the theory has to be anomaly free, which leads to some rules in principle of the charges among the leptons and the quarks, but this is just a side condition, but it cannot be derived from basic principles. While here, charge quantization is implemented at the basic level. This leads me to the full Lagrangian of QCD, which contains the QCD part Then in order to define the gluon proper, in principle, in order to define the gluon propagator, for example, in a consistent way, we have to introduce some gauge fixing in the same way as you are introducing gauge fixing in QED to define the proton, in principle, in order to find the photon propagator. And then something non-trivial happens in non-abelian gauge theories, because if you are introducing a gauge fixing in certain ways, then you are introducing also unphysical degrees of freedom of the gluon which are left in the Lagrangian. Then you have to subtract these unphysical degrees of freedom. And this is a work from the early 70s from Russia, from Impulsiv Fadeev and Popov, that they have introduced ghost fields, which are bosons, but obey Fermi statistics, and therefore these are impossible. No, because impossible, this means that there are no physical particles which are described by the ghosts, but the ghosts are just auxiliary fields, which are kinetic, of course. They also have a kinetic term. And if you're introducing them into the perturbative calculation, you can see that they are subtracting these non-physical degrees of freedom. If you're omitting the contribution of the ghosts, you are getting inconsistent results. So the QCD part contains the kinetic term of the quarks and possibly the interaction of the quarks with the gluons, which is determined by the gauge symmetry. And as I told you, the strong coupling constant is uniquely fixed already in the gauge sector, which means that also the coupling strength here of this interaction is uniquely fixed in terms of the strong coupling, in terms of the strong coupling constant and the normalization of all the generators of SU3. There's no freedom. Then we have the three gluon coupling coming from the kinetic term of the gluon field and the kinetic part of the gluon field, and also the quartic term coming from the kinetic term of the gluon field. Then for gauge fixing, conventionally there are two major gauge fixing options that are used in QCD. First, the Lorentz gauge, that you are fixing the divergence of the gluon fields to be equal to zero in practical terms or equal to a constant. And the X-ray gauge, where you are introducing a gauge vector N, and in principle, suppose that the gluon field is transverse to this gauge vector. In the case of the Lorentz gauge, you have to introduce these Fadeev-Popov ghosts, which are C and CA star here, and they are kinetic and coupling only to a single gluon, and this is important. These ghost fields appear in your perturbative calculation everywhere where you have a three gluon coupling, because the three gluon coupling is the major problem in the framework of this gauge fixing. In the X-ray gauge, on the other hand, you don't have any contribution of Fadeev-Popov ghosts. So this means if you're doing a calculation in the X-ray gauge, then you don't have to introduce Fadeev-Popov ghosts, but your propagator expressions become more clumsy, because somehow, of course, in the final end, you have a safe of work. So this means independent of what you're doing, you always have to do the full calculation. Let me mention also, Fadeev-Popov ghosts also have to be introduced as external particles. So this means if you have a gluon fusion process where the two, in which the two gluons in principle are merging to a single gluon, and then the single gluon split up into a harmonic final state, then for the square of the matrix element, because the ghosts are meant to contribute only to two loops, but the square of a matrix element is always the imaginary part of a gluon loop. And to this imaginary part, of course, also ghosts are contributing, and they have to be introduced also as external fields in order to get a consistent calculation. In the history of our field, there are several examples of wrong calculations because they missed the contribution of external ghosts. Okay, this Lagrangian does not tell you anything if you cannot do something with that, for example, calculation of observables. One of the first issues is that the perturbative definition of the strong coupling constant has been investigated, and this led to a major breakthrough of QCD, which was really the basis that people thought that QCD in a certain limit has perturbative components. And this is the discovery of asymptotic freedom. Let us, in principle, investigate quark-quark scattering with a single gluon exchange, and for simplicity, I'm neglecting the cross diagram here, because you can cross two of these quarks and then you have a second diagram. Then the Born term at leading order can be identified as being proportional to the strong coupling constant, which is the GS squared here at these two different vertices. GS squared I'm normalizing to be 4 pi alpha s. Divided by the Q squared due to the gluon propagator times some part of the matrix element, which involves all the spinors of the external quarks, which is not so relevant here for this investigation. And this capital Q squared is minus small q squared, where small q is the form momentum of the gluon exchange. Then, to this leading order, the diagram, at next leading order, you are encountering radiative corrections, which are depicted here in a more generic way. You have external wave function renormalizations, which are called mass corrections. Then you have vertex corrections, two different types. This is the usual vertex correction that you also know from QED. But now we also have a non-abelian contribution to these vertices. Gluon splitting into two gluons, and these two gluons can couple to the quarks. Then you have also radiative corrections to the gluon propagator, which means you first have a four gluon coupling, which generates a tetpole diagram. Tetpole diagram because this is one head with a tail, and therefore it looks like a tetpole if you're drawing this slightly different. Then we have quark loops, then we have gluon loops, and we have the ghost loops. So the ghost loops have to be taken into account. The tetpole vanishes in dimensional regularization because none of these internal lines inside the loops carries any scale. So the gluon is massless, there's no mass term, and no other scale, and all scaleless integrals in dimensional regularization are vanishing. I hope that this is known to you. Does anyone not know the statement that massless integrals in dimensional regularization are vanishing. If you're introducing a cutoff regularization as in former times, of course these integrals are not vanishing, but they are combining then with a different structure of the other diagrams. Then the calculation of the quark loops is very analogous to the QED case, but then you have to calculate the gluon loops and also the corresponding contribution of the quark loops, of the ghost loops. For the gluon propagator, you can define a polarization tensor, which means that the corresponding tensor carries two different Lorentz indices, one for the left-hand gluon and one for the right-hand gluon. And a major condition due to the local symmetry of SU3 is that this tensor has to be transverse. If you are just calculating, for example, the gluon loop in the Lorentz gauge, you will find that this tensor is not transverse. And this is the major statement that without the ghost loops, there are non-physical degrees of freedom of the gluons. Only if you are adding the corresponding contribution of the ghost loops, and remember that the ghost loops, that the ghosts are obeying Fermi statistics, so you are getting a global minus sign for these ghost loops. Only if you're adding these ghost loops, then this polarization tensor becomes transverse. In this way, of course, you can observe what the ghosts are really doing in terms of the perturbative QCD picture. An alternative would be to use X-ray gauge for all the propagators, then you have a lengthy expression for all the propagators, then you don't have to introduce all the ghosts, and then your polarization tensor immediately is transverse. To make a long story short, because I don't want to get to the details of this calculation, the final outcome is that the strong coupling constant that has to be identified in the same way, also including the radiative corrections M1, and you are neglecting all the infrared singularities which are contained in the vertices, and just concentrate on those contributions which can be absorbed or have to be absorbed in the strong coupling constant. Then you are getting that the strong coupling constant, as in QED, depends on the energy scale at which the strong coupling constant is probed. That the strong coupling constant at a scale Q squared is related to the strong coupling constant at some input scale mu squared by some logarithmic corrections. Important is that here in the denominator there is a plus sign, and if the number of quark flavors, nf is the number of quark flavors, is less than is less or equal than 16, then this coefficient is positive, which means with increasing Q squared, when Q squared is larger than the input scale mu squared, the strong coupling decreases. While in QED, the fine structure constant with increasing scales is increasing. So this is a major difference between non-abelian gauge theories and abelian ones, that in principle, the slope of the gauge coupling constant is really different in a sign. And this sign was the reason for the Nobel Prize in 2004, because the discovery of asymptotic freedom in QCD was that important, because it had dramatic consequences, because since at large scales the strong coupling constant becomes small, there was the idea that at some energy scale QCD becomes perturbative. At small scales, of course, the strong coupling constant is large, And I would like to mention the reason is this factor of 33 over 12. And this 33 over 12 is entirely due to the self-interactions of the gluons, including the ghost loops. So this means the non-abelian structure of QCD makes a dramatic consequence for the phenomenological interpretation of the theory that you have an asymptotically free theory. This has been published in 1973 by two different groups, independently by Politzer and Gross and Wilczek. Rumors say that the first result of Gross and Wilczek was wrong because they had a different sign, and then they were correcting the sign after some discussions, and in this way made both of these contributions in principle agree with each other. However, there is also the statement that in 1972 there was a conference in Marseille where Toft was mentioning after a talk of Szymanczyk, and he was even approaching the blackboard and wrote down this expression of the beta function of QCD, that Brüssel Toft was the first one who had the particular expression of the corresponding beta function of QCD. But this is not entirely true. The first calculation of a non-abelian beta function in SU2 has been performed by a Russian guy, Kriplovich. He didn't have to introduce ghosts because he was using Coulomb gauge, which really makes the whole calculation blow up enormously because you have to take into account many different diagrams with transverse gluons, Coulombic gluons, and all these things. And he reached the correct result. But the problem with theoretical calculations is that you also have to understand the outcome, the implication of the final expression that you got. And Kriplovich did not recognize that this is a possible major breakthrough, that this calculation predicts asymptotic freedom in non-abelian gauge theories. And therefore, of course, the calculation was right, but he was missing the proper, interpretation. Then at small scales, alpha s hits a lambda pole, which means a singularity, which you can see if q squared is equal to mu squared, then, if q squared is getting small, then the logarithm becomes negative and explodes, and this means that at some point you have a cancellation of the denominator and your strong coupling constant diverges. And if you are transforming the q squared behavior to a distance behavior, so q squared is related to 1 over r squared, the distance, then you can see that the singularity happens at distances of about 1 Fermi. 1 Fermi is the typical size of hadronic bound states, so this means that this singularity somehow seems to be connected to the confinement rate, radius, up to factors of 2 or 3, so I don't care, but the order of magnitude is right. So this means the infrared behavior of QCD becomes non-perturbative, and this is related also to the confinement in QCD, but even up to today, the real treatment of confinement is still an open problem because no one knows how to do that. And the only option that we have, quantitative and reliable option starting from first principle to treat the confinement problem, seems to be lattice QCD. But in addition, we can see that radiative corrections are introducing a scale parameter. For example, assume that our QCD Lagrangian doesn't contain any quark masses. Quarks are all massless. Then the whole Lagrangian does not include any mass parameter. But due to the renormalization, you have to introduce a renormalization scale of the strong coupling constant. And this is really a quantum field theoretical implication that a scale parameter in QCD and in any gauge theory is introduced due to the renormalization. Since there is no Thompson limit for small q squared in strong implicit strong interactions, you have to determine alpha s at some intermediate input scale, and this has to be experimentally determined. But this means the determination of alpha s implicit is only meaningful if you are implicit telling the people at the same time at which scale. And this means that the scale is introduced there. Then the whole structure of alpha s, this formula, can be reformulated because the same formula here can be rewritten in this way. 1 over alpha s or q squared is equal to some object which is independent of q squared plus a log of q squared. And then this part which is independent of q squared is replaced by a log of 1 over lambda squared. And this leads to a definition of what we are calling lambda QCD. It's a typical scale parameter of QCD. And then the running strong coupling constant can be also written down in this way. So of course you can calculate lambda QCD from the corresponding measurements of the input parameters in an easy way, but this means that this is just a different expression of the strong coupling constant as a dependence of the implicit of the scale Q squared. So this implicit this QCD scale is in the order of about 100 to 300 MeV. Of course, the number, the size of the scale depends also on the number of flavors that you are taking into account. And the number of flavors, of course, depends on the scale, which is implicit floating through the gluon propagator, because this scale determines if there are large logs related to these quarks or not. Only if there are large logs related to the quark mass, you have to include them into, in principle, the scale depends of alpha s, because this is a very important statement. Scale choices only mean that you're resumming large logs. It's just a tool how to resum large logs, which are in this case related to the running of the strong coupling constant. There's no other reason why to introduce scale choices, because scale choices always mean resumming large logs, and therefore, of course, the theorists are discussing, discussing forever for physical observables what the proper scale choice of a given process is. And there are complicated processes where you have multiple scales involved, and then, of course, the whole issue becomes more complicated. So this means that size of this QCD scale, lambda, depends, of course, on the number of flavors, of active flavors, which are included in the running, and the number of active flavors is determined by the scale at which alpha s is probed. So this means if you're in, if you're just including up, down, and strange, or if you're including also the charm in addition, or the bottom in addition, and the top in addition, there are only a very small selection of observables where the inclusion of the top quark is relevant, because the top mass is so large. But this means that the usual expansion parameter and perturbation theory, alpha s over pi, because also this strong coupling constant is an expansion in alpha s over pi, is smaller than 10 to minus 2 for q squared values larger than roughly 2 gv squared. And this is the range where we think that this is the region of ensured perturbation theory. The larger the scale q squared, the more reliable perturbation theory is. But on the other hand, this is important, that the expansion parameter can be small. So this is a self-consistency that our renormalization group approach or the diagrammatic approach is reliable. It's a self-consistency test. So it means if the input if the input value of the strong coupling constant determined in this way would be huge, then of course you would never reach a range where the strong coupling constant is that small, and in principle at any scales that can be probed up to today at colliders, roughly the TV and few TV range. But since this expansion parameter is small, already for quite small scales, we have a huge range of perturbative QCD where you can trust it and where you can test it. So this means the precision test of QCD, I think that the precision test of QCD and our understanding of QCD is in principle strongly driven by the perturbative approach. In more formal terms, this can be reformulated in terms of renormalization group equations, which means that the first partial derivative with respect to the scale of alpha s, so this mu squared d by d nu, this mu squared d by d mu squared can be rewritten as the derivative with respect to the log of mu squared, is equal to a beta function, and this beta function has a perturbative expansion. Of course, this renormalization group equation only makes sense if you're really in the perturbative range. But the renormalization group equation is a tool where you can control the logarithmic structure due to the running of alpha s, which means this equation can be solved by the separation of variables. So you are putting the d mu squared over mu squared on the right-hand side and divide by the beta function. Then you have d alpha s over the beta function, which only depends on alpha s, because then on the right-hand side you have the log of mu squared as an integral, and then you're integrating this between mu squared and q squared, then the right-hand side has to be integrated from alpha s of mu squared to alpha s of q squared, and this is the integral in general terms that has to be solved. So this means here in this integral, of course, you can use the beta function up to an arbitrary calculated order and calculate this integral numerically, and then by iteration you can obtain a numerical value of the strong coupling constant. But if you're just focusing on the leading order term of the beta function, then this because this means that the beta function is proportional to alpha s squared, then this integral can be done, at least to this expression. And then you are rearranging everything, expressing alpha s of q squared in terms of alpha s of mu squared, then you are getting this expression. This expression has exactly the same form as this, and this coefficient here must be the beta zero then. This is one way how to identify the leading order contribution to the QCD beta function. So this means the renormalization group equation leads to a matching between our explicit diagrammatic explicit diagrammatic calculation, provided that the leading order term of the beta function is this expression. And in addition, the renormalization group equation in this way determines the asymptotic behavior of the running coupling constant, because it resums all the leading logs. Leading logs are those logs which in principle appear as alpha s to the power of n times log to the power of n in any nth order of the perturbative expansion. And these are the complete leading logs which are related to the strong coupling constant. So it means with a particular scale choice, you can control the structure of these leading logs up to all orders in perturbation theory. And this is, of course, equivalent to what I said before. With a proper scale choice, you can resum these logs up to all orders. So this means the leading order beta function is controlling the leading logs, the next to leading order term to the beta function, because then the logs start with an additional order of alpha s over pi. You are resumming the sub-leading logs. With the next term, you are resumming the sub-sub-leading logs, and there's a clear pattern of the logs that you're resumming by this renormalization group equation. The beta function, meanwhile, is known up to the for loop order. One loop, two loop, three loop, and there's a beta three term that is also known since a few years. And explicit expressions have been obtained in the literature. So the two loop term has been calculated first by some Russians, the three loop term by a combination of Russians with European people, and the for loop beta function has been calculated by also a combination of Russian and European people. So the old joke that Russian winters are so cold, so they have nothing better to do than to do these horrible calculations, is not true anymore, because there are also some Western people who are involved in these calculations. Of course, heavily using the modern tools like Form and FormCalc and things like that, in order to be able to combine the thousands of different diagrams that you have to calculate for the running of the coupling constant. And for example, the explicit form of the next to leading order running of alpha s involves some additional factor which depends in the language of the QCD scale on log log q squared over lambda squared divided by log q squared over lambda squared, and you can extend this expansion in 1 over log q squared over lambda squared. This is the 1 over log is the small parameter of this expansion here, because this expression is not exact, it's an approximate expression. This can be extended up to higher orders, and you can find all these details, for example, in the particle data booklet. But the basic feature is that everything is based on this renormalization group equation, and every parameter in the Lagrangian, also the quark masses, obey renormalization group equations, because, yeah. No, I forgot to mention, starting at the three loop order, the beta function depends on the scheme choice of alpha s. So it means this expression here is only valid if you are defining the strong coupling constant in the MS bar scheme. So it means where you are renormalizing by just subtracting the divergences and trivial constants. If you are defining the strong coupling constants, for example, in the momentum subtraction scheme, then of course the beta function is a little bit different. And I will come to some particular example on the very last slide in the fifth lecture. Okay. And this is the outcome, because all these things do not make sense if you're not comparing this to experimental data. So this means what we are really trying to do is to construct a model with which we can really describe the measurements. And the present situation of the strong coupling constant as a function of the scale at which the strong coupling constant has been extracted is shown here. So these three lines are representing the theoretical prediction, including the uncertainties. Of course, every theoretical prediction has uncertainties due to uncalculated higher order effects and some more systematic effects that can be estimated, for example, non-perturbative effects and things like that. And all these error bars and the data points are really the experimental measurements from many, 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 many different experiments. And it is really some propaganda plot that all these measurements are really hitting the theoretical prediction so that you have a very accurate determination of the strong coupling constant at the input scale mu squared equal to mz squared. This is important here to be some prediction which is precise to the level of 1%. And this is really very special because you have a strongly interacting environment, but still you can determine some in parameters to a high precision. And this is really a major achievement of developments in principle of the developments in perturbative QCD, because all these different experiments are at very, very different colliders. So it means a huge set of different observables has been investigated experimentally. For example, tau decays, deep inelastic leptonuclear scattering, heavy quarkonia decay, E plus E minus to hadrons, jet shapes, electroweak precision fits, because there are also the strong coupling constant contributes indirectly at higher orders. Jets at hadron colliders and also top quark production at hadron colliders. And all these measurements are aligned with the theoretical prediction. And this is a big success of perturbative QCD. And this is one of the plots which give us huge confidence that perturbative QCD works very precisely in the energy, in the energy range that is accessible with the present day experiments and the past ones. So are there any questions up to this point? Because it is really important that you understood the basic picture behind that. And that you know why the strong coupling constant determination is a non-trivial task, scale dependent, and how you can control the scale dependence, because the existence of renormalization group equations is an outcome of multiplicative renormalizability of the of the model, and this we know with the general renormalization the general renormalization proofs of Toft and Feldmann from 1970 to 1972, and this was really a major breakthrough in the structural understanding of quantum field theoretical models at that time, and boosted all the developments afterwards. This cannot be underestimated, because in the 60s, for example, I can tell you that Feldmann was somehow smiled at when he was appearing at conferences, that there's the guy dealing with this massive non-abelian gauge bosons, and no one knew at that time how to implement them in a consistent way. And it was due to these few people insisting on continuing studying these frameworks, and also due to Toft, who was a PhD student at that time, who insisted that he wanted to work on that, because Feldmann, due to all these problems on conferences, didn't want to get a PhD student working on that, because he thought that then, of course, he is providing the PhD student to the open knives of the rest of the community. And Toft was really insisting that he works on that, and this was really a lucky feature in our field. Okay. Then, as I told you, every input parameter of the Lagrangian obeys the renormalization group equation, which means also the quark masses, because you can see that the only parameters that we are introducing in QCD is the strong coupling constant and the quark masses in pure QCD. But this is a general framework also in electroweak theory. Of course, all input parameters obey a renormalization group equation in general, also including Higgs couplings. Now, for the quark masses, you can also calculate the scale dependence of the running quark mass by calculating the corresponding diagons. And for the quarks, it is sufficient to calculate the radiative corrections to the quark propagator, the quark self-energy, or the quark two-point function. This self-energy, calculated on-shell, where you're putting p slash equal to n, which means that the self-energy is applied to an on-shell spinor, in dimensional regularization, including masses of the quarks, comes out to be this simple expression. But this only works at one loop, that this expression is that simple. So this means you have a divergence, because this loop is divergent, and all these trivial constants, and mu naught is important, is the Toft mass. The Toft mass has to be introduced in dimensional regularization in order to make this strong coupling constant dimensionless. If you're doing this naively, then your strong coupling constant acquires a dimension up to a power of epsilon in the additional space of a part of space-time due to the fact that you are changing the number of dimensions. And then you can extract the dimensionful factor in terms of the Toft scale, which is arbitrary. So it means in a consistent observable in the final end, due to the fact that all the diversions are impossible dropping out, then also the Toft mass has to drop out. Then this self-energy is inserted in the quark propagator. I forgot to write down the generic expression. Some chalk. So this means that I am replacing the usual quark propagator in Dirac notation like that into a quark propagator which contains the self-energy here. Since the self-energy does not vanish if I'm putting p slash equal to zero, I am displacing the pole of this propagator, which means that I have to interpret this this input parameter m as the bare mass, and only the sum of these two terms, m bare plus the self-energy at p slash equal to m, is providing me the location of the pole and the pole mass. And this means that the pole mass of the quark, the perturbative... Okay, so this means what you are really doing, you take the quark propagator, and then you are adding the quark propagator at this additional gluon in this way, and this leads to the fact that at leading order, the I q slash over m is dressed by the leading order quark propagator, then minus I times the self energy times I divided by the q slash, in principle, the q slash minus m. And this self energy has a decomposition as being m times the scalar part, which depends only on p squared, plus p slash times the vectorial part, which only depends on q squared. This decomposition is advantageous because you are boiling everything down to two scalar functions, which only depend on p squared. And using this expression, you can calculate the sigma s and the sigma v, and you are getting all these predictions. And then you can expand this expression as being sigma s of m squared plus m times sigma v of m squared, plus something of the order of p slash minus m, and these terms vanish on shell. But the next order in p slash minus m defines, for example, the wave function counter term, so that in the final end, the full renormalized self-energy is of order of p slash minus m squared, so it vanishes for all contributions to the diagrams. I hope that this is known from lectures up to a certain extent, but it's important to keep this in mind. If you're adding radiative corrections, you are really modifying all the input parameters, in particular the location of the poles of the propagators, except massless particles. They are in principle, the pole is not shifted in most of the cases. Okay, so this means the pole mass is defined to be equal to the bare mass plus the bare self-energy put on shell. But we are also introducing an MS bar mass as being the bare mass plus an MS bar counter term. And the advantage is the pole mass is really a fixed physical quantity in perturbation theory. The MS bar mass now is a running parameter. So the value of the MS bar mass depends again on the scale choice at which you are probing this running quark mass, which means that the MS bar mass contains this, because the counter term of the MS bar mass contains this half energy, but only that, in this case, only the diversions plus trivial constants, which are contained in the gamma function, because if you are expanding the gamma function, then you are getting the Euler constant and all these things, logs of 4 pi, and all of this is absorbed in the counter term. But then in addition, and this is really something which is really important, This self-energy only depends on the Toft scale, which is just introduced to make in principle the strong coupling constant dimensionless. But now the MS-bar counter term has to introduce the renormalization scale, which is in general different from the Toft mass. So this means we are adding also, if you're expanding this, a logarithm of the Toft mass squared divided by the renormalization scale squared. And this term is important to understand the proper running of the MS-bar mass. Then these two bare masses, of course, are the same, which means I am getting a relation between the pole mass and the MS-bar mass. And the relation between the pole mass and the MS-bar mass can be calculated in such a way that the shift is proportional to the due to the difference between the on-shell self-energy and the MS-bar counter term. Since the MS-bar counter term contains all the diversion pieces of the self-energy, this difference is finite, so that luckily, the relation between the polar and the MS-bar mass is finite. And this can be calculated explicitly by using this expression. And here you are getting an expression which is independent of the Toft scale, because the divergences are cancelling. But instead of the Toft scale, I'm getting the renormalization scale into this object. Now, the perturbative expansion means that the MS-bar mass is equal to the pole mass times a correction which decreases for increasing scales. So, because this means already at this point, I see that also the running MS-bar mass is asymptotically free, which means at large energy scales, where of course it's completely clear that, quark masses are impossible playing a less and less relevant role, in addition, these quark masses become smaller and smaller. So this is a double effect which accelerates the fact that at high energy scales, light quark masses don't play a role unless they are involved in some couplings. Now, renormalization group equations control the resummation of the logs, and these logs factorize. Otherwise, you don't get a proper resummation of these logs, which means in the framework of the renormalization, also this expression has to factorize. So it means this expression has to be because this expression has to be rewritten in terms of a finite correction factor times another correction factor which contains only this log. And then you can show that the MS-bar mass at the scale put equal to the quark mass has a perturbative correction compared to the pole mass, and that the running MS-bar mass decreases with increasing energy scales. This is the because this is in principle the result of the diagrammatic calculation, and these logs are there just at fixed order. And now we would like to resum these logs. Resummation of these logs can be done in the framework of a renormalization group equation. Yeah. Okay. The renormalization group equation defines what we are calling the anomalous dimension, which also has a perturbative expansion here. And this is the same structure of the equation as for the strong coupling constant, the derivative with respect to the log of the scale. Then the anomalous mass, the anomalous mass dimension is just the coefficient in front of this log, alpha s over pi. So this means the leading order term is alpha s over pi plus higher orders. And then you can plug the leading order term and the leading log expression of the strong coupling constant in order to solve this equation, again, by the separation of variables. You can do it easily by plugging in this beta naught and also the scale dependence like that. And then you can calculate this integral. And then you are getting an expression, because then the logs of q squared over lambda squared or mu squared over lambda squared can again be re-expressed in terms of the strong coupling constant by solving this equation. And then you are getting an expression like that, alpha s of mu squared divided by alpha s of m squared to an exponent of 1 over beta 0. And here it's crucial that beta zero is positive, that we are working in an asymptotically free theory, which means since alpha s of mu squared is decreasing with increasing energy scales, also the MS-bar quark mass is decreasing with increasing energy scales, even after resumming the logs which are related to the running of the quark mass. So it means then one can split this final expression in such a way that you are expressing the MS-bar mass as being the renormalization group invariant definition of the quark mass, which is just this object times alpha s of mu squared to the power of 1 over beta 0. Now, this leads to the basic qualitative picture that if you are plotting the MS-bar mass as a function of the corresponding scale, that this quark mass is decreasing, so that also the effective quark mass, which of course, for example, is relevant or for Higgs, also for the Higgs boson decays into heavy quarks, decreases with increasing energy scale. And you can see, for example, for the bottom quark, the pole mass is about 4.8 GeV, independent of all the problems how to define a pole mass. The MS-bar mass is 4.2 GeV at the input scale equal to the bottom quark mass. And at LEP, the effective MS-bar mass at the scale of the Z boson has been determined theoretically to be 2.9 GeV, significantly smaller than the input quark mass. And the MS-bar bottom quark mass has been measured with a lousy precision in Z decays to BB bar, because you are measuring a subleading term. And this was in agreement with the notion that the bottom quark mass is running. So this means also this has been confirmed by experiment, at least qualitatively. Then you can play the same game with the charm quark mass, that mostly the MS-bar charm quark mass is very small at large energy scales. This plays a role, for example, for Higgs decays into a charm enter-charm final state. Then from QCD sum rules, you can also determine the light quark masses, the MS-bar masses, at a scale of 1 GeV squared, and you can see that these light quark masses are really light. All of these quark masses are below 1 GeV, which means that the typical scale set by these quark masses themselves is really in the non-perturbative range of QCD, and therefore one has to be careful if you use the concept of MS-bar masses for the light quarks. The relation between the MS-bar mass and the pole mass can be extended up to higher orders. The relation between the MS-bar mass at the scale of the quark mass itself and the quark pole mass is meanwhile known up to the free loop order. The first term we know, this is the CF alpha s over pi. This is this factor, because you are rewriting this equation by summing up and putting this into the denominator. And then you can see that the two-loop coefficient turns out to be very large, of order 10, which is a factor of 10 larger than the one-loop coefficient. So this means this leads to the problem that for the bottom and the charm, this expression is does not converge that well. For the top quark, it converges, but still there are sizable uncertainties. If you are fitting the MS-bar mass and calculate the top pole mass, you are plagued by uncertainties. And then also the renormalization group equations can be solved, because the anomalous dimension is known up to the for loop level, and the particular expressions that you are getting, again, the scale choices depend on the number of active flavors which are generating large logs, and therefore for all these different scale choices you have to use different expressions for the running of the MS-bar mass. This goes back to a combination, as I said before, between Russians and Dutch people. The last words for the quark mass. For the quark mass, you have some additional problem, which is non-trivial, because this addresses all perturbative orders, because this is the appearance of a so-called infrared renormalon. For example, if you are taking the top mass, MS-bar mass, at the scale of the MS-bar mass to be 163 GeV and fix the alpha s, then you can calculate the top quark pole mass from this MS-bar mass. And you can see that, of course, each perturbative order is decreasing, but not that strongly, so that you are left over with sizable uncertainties for the calculation of the top quark pole mass. This slow convergence can be traced back, and this you have to believe me, because because there's no time to prove that, to the contribution of renormalons in the low energy range of the loop integrals, which are called the infinite range of the loop integrals. Because the main feature is that they are induced by the strong coupling constant as a scale choice of the loop momentum, which can be rewritten in such a way. This is the same expression as before. If you are expressing alpha s or q in terms of alpha s of the top quark pole mass, and then you can expand this expression up to any perturbative order, and this is impossible the pattern that I showed you before. If you are impossible, this is the leading log behavior of alpha s. then one can show that there's an infinite contribution to the last loop integral at the n plus one loop order of that kind, that the loop contribution to the self-energy put on shell is proportional to this coefficient times the integral over b0 to n times log to the power of n. This integral can be calculated, and the basic feature is that this has a factorial growth, which means that the perturbative coefficients are decreasing order by order up to a certain order. So it means you are because this means that you can identify a certain loop order where the perturbative corrections are minimal, and afterwards they are increasing again. And if the series is asymptotic, then you have an alternating series, and then you can build an average. But this means that you are not sensitive to corrections smaller than the minimal perturbative order. And this is an ambiguity that you have in your perturbative expansion. In practical terms, you can replace this n factorial by the Stirling formula for large n, and observe that this minimal perturbative order is reached at loop orders of the order 1 over 2 beta 0 alpha s. For QCD, this is the 8 or 10 loop order, roughly, depending on the size of alpha s, the scale choices. And then we can rewrite this perturbative correction in this minimal order in such a way that we use Stirling's formula and plug in the n0 and also use this explicit expression for this n0. Then we can perform some manipulation, and in the final end up with an expression which is proportional to lambda QCD. Because here in this expression, you plug in the leading log formula of alpha s, and then you are ending up with a minimal perturbative order of the order of lambda QCD. The coefficient is of order one in the framework of the scenario that we have chosen here. And this is the minimal perturbative order, which means that the perturbative expansion cannot produce any smaller effects than roughly lambda QCD. Lambda QCD is then an ambiguity in your perturbative expansion coming from the fact that the perturbative expansion is not convergent. Is only asymptotic convergent. And this leads to some ambiguity in the prediction of the top quark pole mass of roughly 110 MeV. So you cannot determine the top quark pole mass inside perturbation theory by basic principle more precise than up to an uncertainty of 110 MeV. And this is giving you some idea about the limitations of our perturbative expansion. Next to the fact that, of course, our parton picture is only valid up to orders of lambda QCD over a large energy scale, which means that the parton picture only appears in what we are calling the leading twist contribution. If you're expanding a full hadronic observable, then you can expand it in lambda QCD over some typical large energy scale. And this also tells you, so this means if these are my last words of this morning, if you have the prediction of some observable, then this observable expands into a leading twist observable plus some correction lambda over q times a higher twist observable, and then higher orders in lambda over q. And the parton model is only appearing in the leading twist contribution. And this has to be kept in mind, because this also tells you, I will come later to this notion, why for the parton picture you have to go to some infinite momentum frame. Infinite momentum frame in this context means that you are making this high energy scale Q as large as possible so that you can neglect these higher order terms, and these higher order terms are called higher twist terms. So this is the leading twist, and these are higher twist terms. And the higher twist terms are non-perturbative. Part of them has a perturbative component, but the major part of the higher twist terms is non-perturbative and not under proper control, because for non-perturbative effects, we need to rely on some model assumptions, some approximations in order to get control over them. There is, of course, a plethora of models for the non-perturbative effects, but everything impossible has to be confirmed by some explicit calculation, for example, on the lattice or by some other methods. Okay, that's all for this morning. Are there any questions? Okay, thank you very much.